Good morning, church. Hello, I know it's a little bit early, but we just want to get to it. Sorry about that. Can you hear me now? Hello, can you hear me now? Amen. Happy Easter. Today we've come to serve the risen Lord, Jesus Christ, who died and rose again. We're just coming to celebrate and magnify his name. So we're going to start off with a hymn that some of you should know from back in the day. It's a really wonderful hymn, really sentiments of what this is all about. So I'm going to try and lead it, so just bear with me, please, in Jesus' name. Alright, if possible, are you able to stand? Clap your hands, dance, do whatever. All to glorify the Lord. Oh, at the cross, where I first saw the light, and the burden of my heart rolled away. It was there by faith, I received my sight, and now I am the only day. Oh, at the cross, where I first saw the light,
worship band just lead us into a glorious time of worship. Amen. Jesus, this morning, Lord, we celebrate the history-altering event of your resurrection. The veil of darkness transformed to the brightest light. The most dreadful end became the most beautiful beginning. The depths of despair failed to reveal hope everlasting. The curse of death defeated by eternal life. Lord Jesus, by your radiant and magnificent resurrection, you broke the bonds of death and you rose from the grave as a conqueror. You reconciled heaven and earth. How unfathomable is the tenderness of your amazing love. We bow down before you and we worship you this morning, Lord Jesus. We sing with abounding joy of your miraculous rise from death's tomb to resplendent life. Thank you, Lord, for the promise of heaven and your generous invitation of eternal life for all. Okay, we can just watch that video and then we will worship our King. Hallelujah.
Jesus loved. The one thing that I remember from those lyrics was it said Jesus loves us. How many of you believe that Jesus loves you? How many of you believe that Jesus loves you? Let me just ask that again. Are we happy to be here this morning? Yes. It's a glorious day, amen?
Freedom is all.
Who's excited to be here this morning? I said this to the guys when we were practicing this song. You know when we say, out of the dark, so we go, you call my name and I ran out of that grave. He's calling you out of your graves right now.
Amen.
Yeah? There's a note where you hold the, pastors do it, I can hear him very clearly. There's a note he's holding it where he goes, out of the dark, into your glorious day. You call my name and I ran out of that grave. He's like holding it. But you know what? He doesn't want you to hold on that grave. So we're going to change it. We're going to shorten it as much as we can. So call me out of that grave. Just do that, yeah? Let's do an a cappella quickly. Let's see how many of you got it. Okay. You call my name. Keep going.
Out of the darkness into your glorious day.
You can prolong that, yeah.
You call my name and I ran out of that grave.
Hey, that's it.
Out of the darkness into your glorious day.
Let's go from verse 2. Your mercy.
Now your mercy has saved my soul. Now your freedom is all that I know. The old made new, Jesus, when I met you. You called my name and I ran out of that grave.
Heavy, but chains break at the weight of your glory. I needed shelter, I was an orphan. Now you call me a citizen of heaven.
When I was broken, you were my healing. Now your love is the air that I'm breathing. I have a future, my eyes are open.
Shout of praise this morning. Thank you, Jesus. Thank you that you're alive. Thank you, Jesus. We worship you forever, Lord. Let's just close our eyes for a second and just reflect over the words that we just spoke, that he's calling you out of your graves. Some of us hold on to graves that you're not even aware of. When you're holding on to anger, you know you're holding on to that grave, but he's calling you out of it. You're holding on to a sickness that he wants you to let go, but you're like, you know what, I need to take that medicine. He's calling you out of it. He's calling you out of that grave. an addiction. He's calling you out of that addiction. He's saying, my child, just come out of it right now, because I've paid the price. He became sin who knew no sin so that we could be saved. Thank you, Jesus, for the cross.
The Savior of the world was fallen. His body on the cross, His blood poured out for us. The weight of every curse upon Him. As heaven looked away, the Son of God was laid in darkness. A battle in the grave, and the war on death was waged. The power of hell forever broken. The ground began to shake.
Hallelujah. We sing hallelujah, come on church. We sing hallelujah because the Lamb has overcome. Louder, we sing hallelujah. Louder, we sing hallelujah. Oh, we sing hallelujah. The Lamb has overcome. Yes, we sing
this morning, and he reigns. Oh Lord, come and reign in this place. We thank you that you live. We thank you that you live, that we might live, that because you live, we have hope. Hope for today, hope for tomorrow, hope that goes beyond the grave, Lord. We just release your hope in this place this morning. We just release your life in this room this morning. We just release your joy, Lord. Would you just flood us with your joy this morning, your life-giving joy, your life-giving peace, Lord. Where there's anxiety, we release peace in the name of Jesus because you are alive. Where there's depression, we release your joy because you are alive. Because he lives. Because I know. this morning, and life is worth the living just because He lives. One more time. And life is worth the living just because He Place right now as it shall never Thank you, Jesus. Thank you, Jesus. Right, while we're still on our feet, I want us to do something. I want us just to take a nice deep breath. And then I'm just going to do a countdown of three. And I want us to take the roof off this place. And I want the Lord to be magnified in this place, in every heart, and through our voices. Let your shout be so raucous that those outside will know that the King is being hailed in this place. Hallelujah. So I'm going to do a countdown of three. And when I've counted down, I want us to shout out in your loudest voice, hallelujah, thank you, Jesus. Hallelujah, thank you, Jesus. Let us do it loudly. And if it's not loud enough, we'll do it again, and we'll do it again, and we'll do it again. Okay, are we ready? Are we ready? Hallelujah. After 3, 2, 1, hallelujah. Thank you, Jesus. Hallelujah. And the church said, amen, amen. I'm sure that's woken everybody up in the neighborhood. And the Lord is delighted. He inhabits the praises of his people. Amen. What a glorious day. So once again, happy Easter to everybody. Welcome to all of you gathered here this morning, and welcome to everybody that wasn't able to be here in person but has joined us online. We welcome you indeed. We're here to celebrate our risen King. He is risen.
Hallelujah. He is risen indeed. Okay, we are going to meet and greet, but we'll probably just do it because there's so many of us. We will just do it in your immediate vicinity. But first and foremost, I would like to welcome all of those that are here for the very first time. Would you please raise your hand in the air if you are visiting us for the very first time? Welcome. Big warm welcome to you. The welcome team will come round with welcome packs. There's a few things in there just to let you know what we've got going on. And if you are looking, if you're just visiting, it's wonderful having you here. But if you are looking to make IIC your home, then please do fill out the details on the card inside. There's a couple of people up in the balcony. You're really, really welcome. Hallelujah. Okay, while we are right in our seats, there's so many of us, and I think it might be a bit chaotic if we all get up and move around. Can you just turn around and greet somebody and just say, welcome, happy Easter. Good to see you. Hallelujah. 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 Okay, it's so beautiful to see some faces here that we haven't seen in a little while. It's just a real joy. So we trust this is going to be a beautiful service as we just celebrate the risen King. So without further ado, I would like to invite Pastor Harold. Are you ready to come up? Moving straight into the word. Let's just welcome him as he comes all the way back from Texas. And just one extra thing. I've been passed some car keys and house keys by the looks of it. So if anybody has lost the keys, do come and see me. It's Abby. All right. Okay. Thank you, Pastor.
Okay. God is good.
All the time.
And all the time.
Wow.
He's risen.
He's risen indeed.
Yeah, so the way to say it is he's risen indeed. But by the time I'm finished, we'll be saying he's risen and we are risen with him. Okay, so let's start with that at the beginning, and at the end we'll do we are risen with him. Because after you've understood the message, you can say it with confidence. Okay, so let's just say he's risen, and you respond, he's risen indeed. He's risen?
He's risen indeed.
One more time. He's risen.
He's risen indeed.
Like, slap two or three people, high five near you, and just say to them, he's risen. He's risen. He's risen. He's risen. Yes. Yes. Wow. What a great day to be alive, to serve Jesus, and to celebrate the resurrection. Now, I hope your seatbelts are on. I appreciate that there's a lot of us here, the young people and children are all in. So I'm going to communicate in a way that everybody can understand, maybe even demonstrate the message so that everybody would get something out of it. Okay, are we all together? Are we all alive? Ready? Excellent. Thank you so much, Jordan. Thank you. Okay, so the title of the message is the Significance of the Resurrection of Christ. Can we say that together, please? The Significance of the Resurrection of Christ. The resurrection of Jesus is one of the most important events in history. It really is. But understanding it is even better. So, because of time, I will not go into all that it can teach us, but I trust God that we'll get something out of it. So, five things I just want to mention. So if we could go through them together, please. So the resurrection is proof of Jesus is proof that, number one, he defeated death. Can we say that together, please? He defeated death, both physical and spiritual. Number two, the resurrection of Jesus is proof that, number two, he's what? He is alive. Number three, his death was sufficient for our sin. Number four, he is divine. Number five, there is hope for all who die in Christ. Let's do that together again. One, two, three, go please. He defeated death. He is alive. His death was sufficient for our sin. He is divine, and there is hope for all who die in Christ. Are you ready? Are you ready to go into the message? Okay. Now, 1 Corinthians chapter 15 kind of sums it all up. Okay, there's a lot we could teach on for 6 months, but we'll do what we can within the time we've got. Okay, so do you mind if we read together? One, two, three, go, please. For I delivered to you first of all that which I also received. So just a second. So this is the Apostle Paul writing under the inspiration of the Holy Spirit. So he's saying what he has been taught, what he has been given, how he has understood the scriptures is what he's presenting to others so that everybody would also understand. So let's start again, please. For I delivered to you, first of all, that which also I received, that Christ died for our sins according to the scriptures, and that he was buried, and that he rose again the third day according to the scriptures, and that he was seen by Cephas, then by the 12. After that, he was seen by over 500 brethren at once, of whom the greater part remain, but some have fallen asleep. After that, he was seen by James, then by all the apostles. Then last of all, he was seen by me also, who was born as one out of time. So, he only mentions a few names, but those are not the only ones Jesus revealed himself to when he rose up. Actually, the woman saw him first. And then they went and told the apostles. And then they met with Jesus later on. But he just mentioning a few apostles there. Cephas, that's Peter. And then he talks about James. And then he talks about himself. That Jesus appeared to him in a vision later on. As though he was born out of time. Because he didn't actually walk with Jesus when Jesus walked on earth. Okay? So, the resurrection of Jesus was real, and actually people saw him. He said at a point, even 500 saw him all at once. And Jesus showed himself to be alive by revealing himself to the disciples on a number of occasions. Okay, let's continue, please. Verse 12. Can we read together? One, two, three, go, please. Now, if Christ is preached that he has been raised from the dead, how do some among you say that there is no resurrection of the dead? But if there is no resurrection of the dead, then Christ is not risen. Just hold it there. He says, if there is no resurrection of the dead, then Christ did not actually rise. Okay? Because some people were preaching that there is no resurrection, but he's correcting that. He says that Christ was raised from the dead. And if there is no resurrection, then Jesus actually did not rise. Let's continue from verse 14, please. And if Christ is not risen, then our preaching is empty, and your faith also is empty. Just ask somebody, is your faith empty? Just ask them. Is your faith empty? Is your faith empty? Is your faith empty? Is your faith empty? He says, preaching is useless if Jesus did not rise from the dead. Can we say that together, please? Preaching is useless if Jesus did not rise from the scriptures. They don't mean a lot if Christ did not rise from the dead to validate it all. Let's continue. From verse 15. Yes, we are found to be false witnesses of God because we have testified that God had raised him up whom he did not raise up. If in fact the dead do not rise. For if the dead do not rise, then Christ is not risen. Let's bring it to land on this. Now, 1, 2, 3, go from 17. And if Christ is not risen, then your faith is futile and you are still in your sins. This is very important. If Christ did not rise, he's saying that everyone who has come to faith in him is futile, is useless. Preaching is useless. All that we're doing here means nothing if Christ did not rise. But even worse, he's saying that then what he did on the cross was meaningless. We're still in our sins. But thanks be to God, that is not the case. And as we continue, you will see that. Let's continue from 18. Then also those who have fallen asleep in Christ have perished. If in this life only we have hope in Christ, he says, we are of all men the most pitiable. What is he saying? He's telling us that there is life after death, especially for those who have come to Christ. They know they have hope that this life is not the end. There is a life after here, and we will rise again. But as I build on the message, I will emphasize on that later on. Okay, so verse 20. Can we do that together? 1, 2, 3, go, please. But now Christ is risen from the dead and has become the first fruit of those who have fallen asleep. For since by one man came death, by man also came the resurrection from the dead. For as in Adam all die, even so in Christ all shall be made alive. Do you mind if we do that again, please? Verse 22. Let's do it with some emphasis. 1, 2, 3, go, please. For as in Adam all die, even so in Christ all shall be made alive. Just encourage somebody and say to them, in Christ we have been made alive. Just tell two or three people near you, in Christ we have been made alive. Oh, let's say with some vigor, in Christ we have been made alive. Let's give the Lord a clap offering. Hallelujah. In Christ we have been made alive. Verse 23, but each one to his own order, Christ the first fruit, afterward those who are Christ at his coming. What he's saying is that Jesus rose from the dead as the first resurrection to prove that everyone in Christ shall also rise. Amen? At his coming. Oh, I wanted to get somebody to blow a trumpet in this service today. Oh, but I didn't quite manage to organize that. I wanted a trumpet to sound. Now somebody, I didn't know you were coming, Joey. Did you bring your trumpet? Anyway, let's keep going. Okay. So, back to the 5 points I made at the beginning. Jesus' resurrection is proof that he defeated death. It's also proof that he is alive. It's proof that his death was sufficient for our sin. It's proof that he is divine. And it's proof that there is hope for all who die in Christ. Now, the passage we've read kind of reveals some of these things. And I want us to look at, this is my emphasis really in this message, the significance of our resurrection with Christ. If you miss anything I say, please don't miss this one. Those who are in Christ, those of us who have come to know Jesus, don't struggle to believe that he's raised from the dead. The resurrection of Jesus is not a challenge for many Christians, albeit we may not understand the full ramifications of that. But the second aspect of the resurrection of Jesus is that we rose with him. We actually rose with Christ. And by understanding that changes everything. So if in Ephesians chapter 2 from verse 4, actually to do justice to it, let me read the first three verses and then I'll come to the screen. Okay, this is what he says, Ephesians chapter 2. And you he made alive who were dead in trespasses or in sins. And he says, in which you once walked according to the course of the world, according to the prince of the power of the air, the spirit who now is at work in the sons of disobedience. Among whom also we all once conducted ourselves in the lust of our flesh, fulfilling the desires of the flesh and of the mind, and were by nature children of wrath, just as just as the others. Okay. What he's explaining to us is that in this life, it's good to see you, sir. Yes, this is my professor. He's marking my message. Good to see you, sir, doctor. Yes. So, the Holy Spirit wants us to know that Jesus, his death and his resurrection, we were, everyone who believes in Christ. Dan, can I borrow you for a second, please? We didn't rehearse this, so, but you're a good actor, so. So if you hang on the cross for me, please. So, yes, you can tell he's done it before. Yes. He says, he made us alive who were dead in our trespasses and sins. So all of us, the Bible says, for all have sinned and have fallen short of the glory of God, everybody. And everybody needs to be saved in order to enjoy the what Christ has done for us. So on the cross, when Jesus died, everyone who believes in Jesus is found in him. Jerome, if you stand in front of Dan, please. Exactly in front. That way. That's it. That's it. A bit closer. That's it. So, Jerome represents all of humanity. When Jesus died on the cross, he became sin for us on the cross. So, on the cross, we were found in him. Are you listening? Are you listening? Please don't miss this. What did I say? We were found in him. You need to stretch your hands, please. Yes. So, when a person comes to Christ, they are recognizing, I need to come down. You probably need to adjust the camera. Let me. So, we are the sinner is found in Christ. His death was our death. Are we together so far? What did I say? His death was our death. So when a person says, Jesus, I recognize you as my Savior, was saying that I recognize that you died in my place. I know it's a bit hurting. Yes, but you're strong. Are we together so far? So what do we say? His death is what? Our death. If you get that, you get the next bit. His death was our death. So when a person says, Jesus, I recognize that you died in my place, you're saying that I recognize that as you represented me on the cross. Are we together so far? Yes. Then the next bit. Okay, just put your hands down for a second. It's a bit tiring. So, from verse 4. Now let's read that together. 1, 2, 3, go. Everybody. But God. No, you need to say it with some gusto. But God. 1, 2, 3. Again. But God, who is rich in mercy, because of his great love, which he loved us, even when we were dead in trespasses, made us alive with Christ. Okay. Back to the cross. But God. Somebody say, but God. Oh, I can't hear you. I'm louder than all of you put together. But God, who is rich in mercy. Who is what? Rich in mercy. Not somebody and say, God is rich in mercy. God is rich in mercy. God is rich. Come on, guys. Are you alive this morning? I said, God is rich in mercy. Slap somebody high five and say to them, God is rich in mercy. 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 Hallelujah. Somebody give the Lord a clap offering. Hallelujah. God is rich in mercy. God is rich in mercy. God is rich in mercy towards any sinner. There's no sin that the cross did not deal with. There's no sinner that the cross is not sufficient for. The blood of Jesus is sufficient for every sin. There's no rebellion on earth that the blood of Jesus did not deal with. God, who is rich in mercy. So remember, he died our death. Amen. So, if he died our death, then it means that God, who is rich in mercy, because of his great love towards us, even when we were even when we were dead in our trespasses, made us alive. Hallelujah. Oh, somebody say, made us alive. Oh, say it again, made us alive. So we're finished with the cross now. So Jesus has died. He's buried. Okay, so he's buried. He's gone into the tank. He's buried. He's buried. He's buried. He died. He was what? Buried. Guess what happened? We were buried with him, Jerome. Jesus and Jerome, do you think you can come into the tank? Okay. Yes. This is important. If you get this, it will change your life. So Jesus has to go first, please. And then we were buried with him. Don't go. Yes, that's right. Yes, stay on the step. Stay on the step. That's fine. Yes. So, Jesus died and he was buried. Everyone who believes in Jesus, he died our death. And then we were buried with him. So, you need to just go down a little bit. That's it. What happened here? I can't hear you. What happened here? He died our death. We died with him. And what happens here? We were buried with him. Now, in the grave, Jesus rose from, he became alive and he rose up. Listen to this. If you miss this, you've missed my message. If you get it, it can change your life tremendously. Everyone who believes in Christ is found in Christ. So he died our death, we were buried with him, and we were made alive. In the grave, life from the Spirit came upon Jesus. So Jesus rose up from the grave. What did I say? Jesus did what? He rose up from the grave. But guess what? Guess what? Everyone who has come to him, who has acknowledged that he died in their place. It has to start here. You can't start here. You have to start here. Are we together?
Yes.
Are we listening? He died our death so that we would not need to face death. And then he was buried. And those who come to Christ are buried with him. Our old life dies. Are we together so far? So as Christ was raised from the dead, so also all who come to Christ, Jerome, have risen with Christ. We've been raised with Christ. Do you mind coming? Just come this. So, please. Let's see. If you stand there. The believer is found in Christ. What did I say? Oh, please don't miss it. This is not like just drama. This is revelation. The believer is found in Christ. If you get it, it will transform your life. So, we died with him. We were buried. This is spiritual stuff we're talking about. You say, I wasn't there. I know that. But it happened spiritually. And it's a reality. And when he rose up, we were found in him. So then he tells us, even when we were dead in our trespasses, he made us alive. The Father made us alive with Christ. And then he reminds us, by grace, you are saved. Just encourage, remind somebody, it's by grace. 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 It's by grace means you can't deserve it. You can't earn it. You can't earn it. It's the grace of God. It's God's favor. It's God's mercy. Available to all people. And as we illustrated there, he raised us up together with him. Can I have a seat? Yeah. Can I have my chair there, please? You need to unhook it. Thank you. You guys will have to share. So, listen. What happened here? I can't hear you. What happened here? What happens here? You've been raised together with him. And now he says, and then he seated us together. Just try and share the chair for me, please. It's an illustration. Now, please catch this. If you catch this, it's life transforming. I believe that the Father really wants us to grasp the fact that our identity is in Christ. Everything he did for us. Jesus didn't need to die if there were no sinners. He did it for us. Are we together so far? He was buried for us. He rose up for us. And now the Bible says, and he made us to sit together in the heavenly places in Christ Jesus. This is where it gets really, really exciting. Because in chapter 1, verse 21 says, far above all principality, and power, and might, and dominion, and every name that is named, not only in this age, but also in the age to come. The believer who has died with Christ, been buried with Christ, has risen with Christ, is now given authority in Christ. That is why we can pray, in the name of Jesus. And things happen. Are we together? Because we have been made to be seated with him in heavenly places above principalities and power. That's why we can command demons to flee and they flee. That's why we pray for the sick and they are healed. That is why we do things in the name of Jesus. That's why we're called to be salt and light in the earth, because we do it in the name of Jesus. And then he goes on to say that he's made us for good works. But it all stems from seeing that we have been made alive in Christ. Oh, if you see it, it will change the way you live your life. Listen to this other passage. Romans, I'm rounding up soon. Romans chapter 8, verse 1 and 2. Do you mind if we read that together? 1, 2, 3, go, please. There is therefore now no condemnation to those who are what? In Christ Jesus, who do not walk according to the flesh, but according to the Spirit. Verse 2 is profound. Let's read it slowly. For the law of the Spirit of life in Christ Jesus has made me free from the law of sin and death. I know sometimes when you read this, it's like, what does it mean? You got to read it again. Read it again. Read it again. Verse 2. For the law or the Spirit of life in Christ Jesus has made me free from the law of sin and death. What's he saying? Wow. What's he saying? On the cross, Jesus defeated death. And the law of sin and death, which has been operating in humanity since the fall, Jesus dealt with it permanently on the cross. So the believer who sees themselves in Christ. That's the key. Many people don't see themselves in Christ. So we struggle. But when the believer can see by the help of the Holy Spirit that I am in Christ, then you recognize that he has dealt with the law of sin and death. Therefore, I don't have to live under the dominion of sin any longer, because I have been made one with Christ. Are we together? And now there's a new law at work in the believer. It's called the law of the Spirit of life that is in Christ. So the law of sin and death has been dealt with, so that the law of the Spirit that flows from Christ works in us. That is why the believer can be like Christ, bear his fruit, exhibit his gifts, and act like Christ. When the Father sees us, he sees us through Christ. Glory to God. Glory to God. There's a lot. I could go on this for a while. But I pray that you grasp what I'm saying here. Holy Spirit, I pray, open the eyes of our understanding that we might grasp it. Children can grasp this. If we teach them correctly that they are found in Christ, and that the law of the Spirit of life from Christ is what is flowing in us, it means that I don't need to live under the dominion of sin any longer. Because Christ, I died with Christ. Somebody say with me, I died with Christ. Okay, let me rephrase that. Say that if you are a follower of Jesus, okay? And if you're not, this could become your reality. So we say it again. I died with Christ. Or even better, Christ died on my behalf. Christ died on my behalf. Christ was buried on my behalf. And Christ rose again on my behalf. So Christ is the one from whom life flows. His life flows to us. That is why we can confidently say, there is therefore now no condemnation. Hallelujah. There is therefore now no condemnation for those who are in Christ Jesus. Give the Lord a clap of praise. I know sometimes it takes a while to get our head around these truths. That is why in Ephesians chapter 1, the Apostle Paul prays, Lord, open the eyes of our understanding. Because for many Christians, our spiritual eyes are blurred. Some of us even have our spiritual eyes closed. Do you mind closing your eyes for a second? The prayer should be, Lord, open my spiritual eyes. I encourage you, those of you who still have young children, oh, if only I had the chance to start again, I'll tell them some stuff that I know now. One of the most important prayers you can pray is, Lord, open my spiritual eyes. Can we say that, please? Lord, open my spiritual eyes. If we can see this, we'll live differently. You will not live under condemnation, because you've been set free from the law of sin and death. And by the help of the Holy Spirit, we choose to live a life that pleases God. As I round up, he says, his divine nature has given us all things that pertains to life and to godliness. Because of time, let me just, you know, the place I've highlighted, he says he's invited us so that we can be partakers in his divine nature. Father, help us to see it. That Jesus died our death. And when he rose, we rose with him. That we might live lives differently. Let's do this passage together. I round up in 5 minutes. Let's see. This is Jesus' words. 1, 2, 3, go, please. Jesus told her, I am the resurrection and the life. Anyone. Wow. You know, Simon, I was thinking about the question. The question that Jesus asked, do you believe this? I think is the greatest question. Do you believe this? You know, when Jesus rose from the dead, he told them he was going to rise. But they either forgot or they doubted. They didn't believe it. So then, we still struggle to believe some stuff. So Jesus asked her, do you believe this? And the question is still real to us, do you believe this? Jesus is still asking all of us today, do you believe this? Because what you believe will change your life. Do you actually believe this? He says, I am the resurrection and the life. Those of you in the balcony, are you there? Can you hear me? I am the resurrection and the life. Anyone, can we say that together, please? Anyone.
Anyone.
This is true for anyone who believes it. Oh, may God find at least one person that can believe this. 2 people, 3 people, a church family that can believe this. Anyone who believes in me will live. Why? Because he took our death. He says, even after dying physically, you're still living. So the believer does not die spiritually because Jesus defeated death. That's why everybody needs to be in Jesus. He's the only one who guarantees that we can have life. And he says, everyone who lives in me and believes in me will never die. Will never die. Because we've crossed from death to life, from darkness to light. We are in Christ. He died once. He's not going to die again. And now we live through him. That is why the resurrection is very significant. Because it represents our death and our resurrection so that we can live. Live through Christ. Do you mind if we, as I draw this to a close, just conclusion. Believing in the resurrection of Jesus is necessary for salvation. Believing in our resurrection with Christ is necessary for victorious Christian living. I leave you with that. Believing in the resurrection of Christ is necessary for salvation. For if a person believes that Jesus died and rose again, he shall be saved. Or she shall be saved. Anyone who believes that. And today, if you're listening, either online, you're physically in this space, and maybe you even come and you've come to the services regularly. If you believe that Jesus died and rose again, the Bible says you shall be saved. But it's not enough. After that is believing that we rose with him. That is the key for the believer. To live differently so sin will not have dominion over us any longer. That we can represent Jesus in this life. I'd like to pray. Thank you, guys. Please appreciate them for me. Thank you so much. Thank you. Thank you. Please, this is a very solemn moment, and I really would like to invite you to take it seriously. If you believe that Jesus died and rose again, you're saved. If you have not yet done that, today is a golden opportunity for you to do that. So can I invite anyone who would like to say, I would like to believe that. Jesus, I want to believe that you died and you rose for me. If you've not yet done that, what a great invitation today to say, Jesus, I believe you died my death. I surrender my life to you. If that's you, maybe even if it's one person, it's worth it. If you've never surrendered your life to Jesus, today is a good opportunity to say, Jesus, I surrender my life to you. Whether you're in the balcony, you're down here, or you're watching online, or you're watching this afterwards, have you yet surrendered your life to Jesus? If not, why not today? Is there anybody here who would like to say, Jesus, I give you my heart, I give you my life? Anybody? For the first time, say, Jesus, I surrender my life to you. Anybody would like to do that? Anybody? I'd like to say, Jesus, I surrender my life to you for the first time. Anybody? Just raise your hand and put it down again. Anybody like that? Okay. If you're contemplating on it, you're wondering that people might be looking at you, I'd like to give you an opportunity to just consider just inviting Christ into your heart. So maybe you can pray with me. Maybe we can pray this together and help those who are thinking about it. Can we pray together and say, Lord Jesus, I thank you that you died my death that I might live. I recognize that my sin took you to the cross. I ask for your forgiveness for everything I've ever done. Forgive my sin. I choose to surrender my life to you. I believe you died and you rose again. Thank you that in you I find life. Amen. Let's give the Lord a clap of praise. And for the majority of us who are already believers, I want us to just surrender our lives to him afresh, thanking him that he died our death, that he's made us alive, to live the resurrected life for his glory. Do you mind if we just lift up our hands to him? Yes, Lord. Yes, Lord. Just thank him. Thank you. Thank him that he died our death and he's made us alive. That because of his resurrection, we also can live the resurrected life. Not only in this life, but in the life to come. We shall rise again physically from the grave when he appears. That is wonderful news. Thank you. Thank you. Thank you. Thank you. Thank you, Jesus. We're going to come to the communion table in a minute. By taking communion today, we want to thank him that he died our death and he rose again, that we might rise, that we might live the resurrected life in him. Thank you, Lord. Can I invite the service to come forward, please? Sorry, I think I missed a hand. If you want to give your heart to Jesus today, I might have missed you. You might have put it up slowly and I didn't see. Please, after the service, we'd like to pray with you. This is one of the most important decisions you can ever make. So the night on which he was betrayed, he took bread. And he broke it. He gave thanks. He gave thanks as he broke the bread. And he said, "This is my body that is broken for you. This is my body that was crucified for you." The servers are going to come around. Just hold on to your emblems. We're going to take it together. So can I invite Brother Simo, would you just come and just pray? Just come. Just give him a mic, please. Can he have a mic? Yeah. Just give him a mic. Just pray and give thanks, please.
Yes, thank you. Father, we want to thank you how your body was broken for us so that we could have fullness of life in you. Just as we've heard, Lord, in you we died and in you we have been made alive. And not just individually, but I guess your body speaks also that we are the body of Christ together as your followers. You did not just unite us with yourself, but with one another as well. So, Lord, we thank you for your sacrifice. We thank you for your body that was given for us. Thank you, Lord.
If you could just play the song we had on Friday, just bring up the lyrics. And so when the emblems come, just take it, hold on to it, we'll take it all together. Thank you. And in the same way, you took the cup after supper and said, "This is the cup." Are you happy for us to stand together, please? If you've been served, please. As the worship team sings this song, if you'd like prayer, feel free to come forward. I think the parents, Sophie, where is Sophie? Is she gone through? Okay. So if you want to take your child to the Easter egg hunt, we'll do that afterwards. Okay, so we'll do this song. If you like prayer, please feel free to come forward. And then we'll round this bit up, and then the children can go and do their bit. Okay, thank you.
Sealed the promise.
Hallelujah. Praise God, our living hope. If you just want to take your seats just for one moment, as we round up, just a few notices just to let you know what we've got going on. So right after the service now, we do have the Easter egg hunt. So if you just want to come through to the minor hall with your children, I'm not quite sure where Sophie is at the moment. Oh, there you are, Sophie. Where did you want the children? Minor hall or here or? Yeah? Okay. Okay. So you want people to gather in the minor hall and you can all go together. So through to the minor hall and then you can all go through to the next door building to the garden. Okay, Sophie will lead on that one. Okay, that's today. And this evening we have got a baptism service. So excited. What a beautiful day to be baptized on Easter Sunday. How glorious is that? We're excited. That will be at 6 p.m. tonight. So if you're able to join us and celebrate those that are being baptized, that would be wonderful. They're going to be risen up tonight with Christ. Hallelujah. Okay, and also next Sunday, something else really exciting. We have got the service being taken over by our youth. Our youth are leading next Sunday. They will be running the service. They will be running the show next Sunday at 11 a.m. So that will be exciting. And also, it's really hard talking about Christmas on Easter Sunday, but nevertheless, we have got plans in motion for a Christmas carol production Christmas, but we're starting early. And shall I announce it or do you want to do it, Sarah? We are calling all singers. Can we have that slide up? All singers. If you have a voice, would you like to be part of the choir for the Christmas production, A Very Christmas Carol? If you would like to be part of that choir, then please do see Steve. Steve is back there on the bass, who sung so wonderfully at the beginning, or Kay. Kay isn't here today, or any of the worship team, I'm sure, can lead you in the right direction. So if you've got a voice and you'd like to be part of that choir, do please step up. Okay, and then just an opportunity to give as we round up. It is good to give. And I'm sure we've all got joyful hearts today. So just some opportunities and ways we can give. You can do that via the QR code, which you see up on the screen. There's also a black box at the back there. If you need an envelope, you can ask one of the welcome team for an envelope and you can pop it in the black box. Or there's also the transfer details, the bank details up there for a direct transfer. Okay, we're going to round up now. Should we just get up on our feet one more time just as we wind up and just worship as we go out? Hallelujah. Have a wonderful, beautiful, and very, very blessed Easter Sunday. God bless each and every one of you.
Jesus Christ, my living.
See you all this evening.